So my platform that I'm building and the program that we're starting here is Spread Goodness TV. And the idea behind Spread Goodness TV is to uplift the vibration of the planet through acts of human kindness and generosity of spirit, but to take issues that are important also and ground us in what we can do to make this world a better place. How can we create from this place? How do we envision more of what we want to see and then go out and create that? Because I believe we do have that power.
It is true, we are living through a watershed moment, a turning point in our personal lives and for our world community. There are critical concerns we need to address as individuals, as a nation, and as humans sharing one planet. My goal with Spread Goodness is not to deny what's true and scary in our world, but possibly offset some of the negativity we consume on a daily basis by showcasing what is good in our world. There's a lot of it. Perhaps it will replenish us, remind us who we are at the core of being human. What a miracle it is to be here on this planet at this moment in time, and possibly inspire us to do what we can to make our world a better place. This is Spread Goodness TV. A year ago, we launched our first episode of Spread Goodness TV. The goal was to offset the negativity we consume through so many other forms of media and focus on what's good in our world. So join me as we go back to 1 year ago when we aired our first episode.
Hi, my name is Lisa Lang, founder of Spread Goodness and host of Spread Goodness TV. Welcome to our very first episode. For many years now, it has been my dream travel around the globe, shining a light on all that is good in the world. And there's a whole world of good right here where I live in Santa Barbara.
We started with two young ladies who embody the spirit of Santa Barbara and were instantly inspired by their extraordinary talent and desire to uplift others and spread the joy and love.
When I was five, I think I went up to my instructor, Daniela, and I told her that when I was older, I wanted to try out for Junior Spirit, and I told her specifically I wanted to have a shawl and a fan and my own solo.
They each exhibit where big dreams can lead us.
I actually have a really similar story.
Yeah.
I think I was 4 years old, and I was at Lacumba Plaza with my mom, and I saw the Junior Spirit dancing. I looked up to my mom, and I basically said the same thing. I said, "Mom, I want to dance. I want to be the girl in the white dress."
And that's exactly what they did. I so enjoyed talking with them and hearing about their sisterly bond.
But I think, like, our bond is stronger than most spirits. Like, we still do a lot of things together, and I think that's really special.
And of course, their favorite parts of being spirits of Fiesta, despite the challenges and unique circumstances of 2020.
My favorite part, definitely all the time, is just performing in front of lots of people. And I just, what makes me so happy is afterwards, it's just when people come up and they say how much they liked it, but not only, it's just the smile on their faces and the joy that just makes me smile too. And that's definitely one of my favorite parts, is that I'm just so grateful that I'm able to have the opportunity to bring joy to everyone. So I feel very lucky that I'm able to do that.
I mean, that's what the arts can do. They have the power to uplift others.
Yeah, for me, it's really similar to Savannah. I have such a strong passion for flamenco. It's kind of just been what I've always done my whole life, and I've dedicated so much time and effort to that, and it's what I love to do. So being able to share that with other people is a big joy for me, and I love when I'm able to inspire younger girls or younger boys, especially like the little ones. And I just like love being able to motivate someone else to pursue a way to express themselves, just like the way I was motivated by the Junior Spirit. Being Spirit of Fiesta means to me is basically just having like the opportunity and the platform to use my voice and my dancing to be able to just, like Savannah always says, just spread joy and bring the spirit of Fiesta. And I think that the title Spirit of Fiesta can be taken literally, because that's why we were chosen to really bring the spirit.
And Issa so articulately encapsulated the spirit of spread goodness.
I think that with the pandemic and with so many other things going on in the world, the one thing that we can do is like come together to do something. Do little things for each other. It doesn't even have to be like a big gesture, just like little things that can make a difference in someone's day, which can make a difference in someone's week, which all these little things add up and just like make your quality of life just better. And I think that when we can do that for each other, we can also receive that back.
Before sharing a special dance performance with us. Our next episode featured a young lady, 9 years old at the time of our interview, who endeavored to make it her mission to find homes for the animals in a local shelter. Lulu Guess exhibits the power we all have to make a difference in the world.
I love helping animals, and that's one thing I really love doing. I just hope that they get good homes and that they all get treated fairly and that they just don't get tested on. You know, it's not fair, right? Like, they shouldn't get tested on for science experiments. She just looked at us like, I really, really want a home. And I was like, why don't we do a project for these animals? And we just got a poster board and we just decorated the photos and glued them up and had all their names. And then just says, come adopt us with all the information. Mm-hmm. And then that has really helped, because my dad actually filmed someone getting out of his car, coming and looking at the sign, and like 3 people have done that now.
Wow.
And then recently my mom looked on the site and 2 of them already got adopted, and we got to write adopted next to their names out on the sign.
That's gotta feel really satisfying.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I bet you like at least lots of animals are getting adopted. I feel it.
Yeah.
I'm certain that they're going to.
She shows us that it doesn't matter what age one might be. Anyone can be an animal activist or any type of activist if they're working towards something they truly believe in.
I've actually heard of a lot of animal activists, and they just stood up for what they really believed in, and I feel like I could do the same thing if I just really wanted it to happen. Mm-hmm. As I said, I'm certain that they are going to get all adopted into good homes.
Mm-hmm. And they were. We were informed prior to airing this episode that all the animals that were at the shelter when Lulu started her mission were eventually adopted. Mission accomplished!
Just having really that determination just gives me so much power to think that I can very much help them have a good home.
And what helped her accomplish her goal? For more inspiration from Lulu, check out episode 2. On 4th of July, we ventured out into the community of Santa Barbara to ask what we are celebrating on the 4th of July and what freedom means to people, and also received poignant responses to how we as a country might move forward in a more united way. It was a traumatic day for me. I woke up to texts from my sister notifying my family that she and my dad were safe. I soon found out that while she and my dad were on the rooftop of her apartment building watching the parade in my hometown of Highland Park, an active shooter had just killed 7 people and injured 36 more. I delayed our scheduled filming for Spread Goodness and strongly considered canceling it altogether. But by the afternoon, knew that this was how I could do my part, no matter how small, to contribute to a world that is in desperate need of repair. While devastated, I felt fueled to do something which made these subsequent interviews that much more meaningful to me.
The world we live in isn't perfect. It's not something to feel positive about, but we do have a power to create what we do want to see in the world. I strongly believe in our power to create that world, and in order to create that world, we first have to envision it. And by seeing things that we love, by seeing the things that are working, it helps us to believe in that vision. At least that's what I believe. So the questions we're asking today are, what are we celebrating today?
The 4th of July, the birth of our country, 1776 today.
Mostly means celebrating our, like, where we live, and mostly our freedom that we got here, and any, like, celebrating all of us that we came here and people that came from Mexico, different places in the world.
Independence Day.
And what does that mean to you?
Having freedom, I guess.
We love Santa Barbara, we love our life here, but it doesn't compensate for catastrophe, for terror and tragedy. It doesn't compensate.
There's a lot of things going on in the world, but I am really hopeful that my country can change where it's at right now. And I'm really, really hopeful for, like, our future. And I really, really enjoy living most of the time in a country, but mostly a state that I really, really love and a place that I really, really love.
I'd like to just ask, what does freedom mean to you?
To me, freedom is the ability to go out and kind of chase the American dream, you know, to start your own business and to try to make success of yourself and success for your family. And I think I'm just grateful. I think we should all be grateful for the men and women who've sacrificed so much to give us this freedom. And as much as sometimes the freedom hurts when others take advantage of it, it's what our country's founded on. So I'm thankful for that.
Freedom means, like, I could do anything I want. I don't have to do what people say to me. That, like, I can do whatever I want. I just don't have to, like, listen to other people that want me to do this specifically or specific job. I can do whatever I want, mostly.
Okay, you could create the life you desire.
Yeah.
To me, freedom means being willing to sacrifice for stuff you believe and decisions you believe you have the right to have.
Okay.
In this world, and it means different things to different people, but sacrifice is always there.
So what's one thing that we can do to move in the direction of good as a nation?
I think understanding that there are a lot of things at work beyond your person, mm-hmm. and not taking it like it's just you. Like, as a country, there's a lot that we can do in, like, as a group, if we come together, if we put differences aside, and if we, like, spread positive messages, I think there's a lot of things that can be done to bring us together.
Just listening to the other side and hearing their point of view, and just listen to why other people are so upset, and understand and not point fingers at them, and that usually solves most issues. I wake up and say, today is something awesome is going to happen, and then you look for it, and then I say three things that I'm thankful for that can't be the same as the day before.
Love that.
Yeah, can't be the same ever.
Right.
We were so pleased with all the interviews we were able to snag that day, but realized that everyone, for the most part, came from the point of view we shared, and we wanted to hear from someone who came from a different perspective. And wouldn't you know, just as we were packing up, we met Cameron, whose political views were clearly diametrically opposed to my own. However, I practiced my listening skills, and I'm so glad I did. This ended up being one of my favorite interviews all season long.
It's a great day to be American right here.
All right. Tell me, what are we celebrating today?
Freedom right here. A lot of people don't understand what it takes to be free, and I think I'm one of the few.
Tell me more.
I'll tell you more. Okay. For first and foremost, no other country is able to speak free. And what I say is, they cannot cuss out their president. They can't say what they love. And I'm very grateful for this country.
Okay.
And what we stand for and what we've came from. And okay. I'm happy to be here, baby.
All right. We're happy.
American, dude. Everybody should be happy. I don't understand the controversy.
Okay. What do you think the controversy might be?
the controversy might be. I mean, a lot of people want to come down to like racism or stuff like that, but everybody has their flaws, and at the end of the day, I think we should be grateful for what we have, because this country stands for freedom. Everybody is an immigrant. Everybody is welcomed here, and everybody can make a path. Everybody could become successful here, and I'm so fortunate for that, because so many places they're born into, you know, lower income, and they have no other path to come from. And here we can become great. We can become, create a path for our future that is to come, and I'm happy. What I think needs to happen is we can't get rid of our guns because we can't trust the government. What we need to do is we need to touch upon the mental state of this country. There's obviously a bad problem with how, you know, there's problems. You know, a lot of people they're sad, and that's the social media aspect. People look around and they're not happy with they are. We have a mental state that is wrong with this country. That is what's wrong. People are unhappy, and that's why they're shooting it up.
And here's my favorite part.
Thank you so much. I really do appreciate your perspective.
Yeah, I appreciate you. Thank you. I think you agree.
I don't necessarily agree.
Okay, what don't you agree with?
Wait. But what I think is really important is that we start listening to each other.
And well, I really appreciate. Well, me too. Well, now I'm curious to hear your standpoint.
Okay. Are you sure?
No, that's fine. Let's hear your standpoint.
Well, and Cameron, if you're out there, or if anyone knows Cameron, I would love more time to sit down and discuss important issues that we may not agree on, but perhaps can find some common ground. So please feel free to reach out. The following segment received almost 3,000 views and the WAVE Award for Excellence in Local Cable Programming. Yes, Spread Goodness TV is now officially an award-winning TV show. But perhaps even more importantly, this coverage raised awareness for an important local issue. It was a tangible piece that members in our community could grasp the impact of a pending development project in the beloved Funk Zone of Santa Barbara. This video helped attract a record-breaking number of over 100 participants to provide their feedback at the Architectural Board of Review meeting. Currently, we hear the project is shelved, and there's no doubt we helped mobilize our community to speak out at a critical moment.
Stuff. And so the idea of the impetus is like, well, I got this space in the community. I've got to figure out what to do. And my goal was to give it back to the community.
We had the great pleasure of meeting one of our very own Funk Zone artists and shop owner, Julie Schneiderman, co-owner of Stick and Stuck, a community creative event space. She represents the spirit and eclectic, creative, and organic vibe of one of Santa Barbara's top destinations.
Being what gets me excited is just how other people are excited that come in here. And so that they have ideas and then they spur on. And so we just keep expanding and keep expanding and figuring out what's next. So, and blends the funk and the art and keeping that part of our community here. So that's the important part. I'm trying to keep the funk sound funky, or at least bring some of the funk back. It's changed a lot, and so now we've kind of taken this as an opportunity to bring the funk back. So far, we've had really great public response.
In the second part of this episode, we featured Dart Garden, one of my favorite spots in the Funk Zone, and talked to Jenny Tucker, founder of Centerline Community. Like so many others, Jenny uses this space to gather on a regular basis with local moms.
Yeah, we come here, so we're the Centerline Community. It's a support community for new moms and expecting moms. And we bring our little ones here every Friday. Mm-hmm. And it's like, because it's enclosed and there's places to sit and things to interact for them, it's super enjoyable for us to be able to like actually have coffee and hang out. Yeah, we're all about just being honest about motherhood and talking about what it's like and lifting each other up rather than feeling like we have to do it on our own or not talk about the hard times, because it's a lot of joy, but it's a lot of other stuff too.
And while the hope is that we can all continue to gather here in this special space, the future of the Dart Garden is uncertain. We move on from a local issue to one that questioned our ability to preserve humanity's honor on a global scale. In 1986, Rabbi Harold Schulweis, Malka Drucker, and Gay Block decided to document activities of non-Jewish Europeans who risked torture and death to save Jews during the Holocaust, a topic they considered both important and underpublicized. Their work would eventually lead to a book by Drucker, Rescuers, Portraits of Moral Courage in the Holocaust, as well as an exhibition of Bloch's photographs. I had the privilege to sit down with Rabbi Malka Drucker to hear her firsthand accounts of meeting rescuers who risked everything to save Jews during the Holocaust. It was fascinating to hear from her experience what qualities differentiated rescuers from non-rescuers during that horrific time.
So this woman,
okay,
the Countess Maria Maltzahn, Gräfin Maria Maltzahn, mm-hmm. a veterinarian, interviewed her in East Berlin, in the house where she hid Jews.
Yeah.
And let's see, I want to see if I can actually use her words here. Mm-hmm. Here, my mother hated Jews and told me never to marry one.
Wow.
It was easy for me to resist Nazi authority because I had always resisted my mother's authority.
Oh, interesting.
I think it was because she was such an unjust person and treated me so unjustly that I have such a strong feeling for injustice.
Wow.
One quality that stood out among everyone she met was
they had this intolerance to injustice. These two guys were best friends, and this one, you know, like, well, why did I do it? I mean, they could be cats or Eskimos. I couldn't see this happening to them. There were just some people who couldn't bear to see what others turned their eyes from. Mm-hmm. Marion Pritchard was Dutch. She was a psychoanalyst. We met her in Vermont. She was among the youngest. She was not 60, I think, when we met her. And she was 18 years old in the School of Social Work in Amsterdam. And she did come from a good family. And she was raised with tolerance. And she also said, and socially, none of my parents' friends were Jews. She tells a story. She's out in the country with three children. And three Jewish children, and knock on the door, and in comes the Nazi and the Dutch collaborator, who knows, but she knows they're gonna, and she has a hole in the floor, puts a carpet over it, the kids go down there, mm-hmm. and it's all good. The kids come out, and the collaborator is smart enough come back unexpected, unannounced, and there are the children, and she has a pistol.
Wow.
And she shoots him.
Wow.
Malka explains.
Yeah.
You've got victims, persecutors, mm-hmm. rescuers.
And non-rescuers.
Bystanders.
Bystanders, yeah.
And most at that time were bystanders. She used the following metaphor to illustrate who the rescuers were among the majority of people at that time.
And they're most. I think the metaphor I used was a teardrop in an ocean of indifference.
The question for me always remains, who among us could do what they did if faced with unimaginable circumstances of such magnitude that puts our humanity in question? But Malka pointedly reframes this question.
Look, the first thing I did ask myself was, you know, could I have done what they did? Mm-hmm. But then I realized that the real question they were putting in me that I couldn't stand is, what am I doing now?
Mm-hmm. In our next episode, my videographer Jake and I quite literally went to town, highlighting some of our favorite places to eat, shop, and be in Santa Barbara. We started in the Funk Zone at Dart Coffee Company and Dart Garden, one of my favorite spots to relax with friends, read a book, journal, or just sip my coffee and take in the beauty that surrounds me. Then grabbed lunch at Metropolis Fine Food Merchant, where it's clear that they have a passion for good, simple food. I can't wait to try everything on their extensive menu if I can ever tear myself away from my new favorite Italian sandwich, the Italian Job.
Everything's made in-house from scratch. I think that's why our food speaks for itself. It's just really, yeah.
You can tell the difference.
You can tell the difference.
Homemade. And,
yeah.
Then headed to State Street to an endless array of unique treasures at Urban Flea Market. There's literally something for everyone here.
Yeah. There's just so much to see, and we love, you know, it's a very playful store. Yeah. And you'll see as we walk through. But
I can't wait to see. All right.
If you can't find it here, you can't find it.
And ended our day playing in one of Santa Barbara Botanic Garden's newest attractions, Backcountry, where we got to explore varied terrain, special habitats found in Southern California, and take the path less traveled. I can't wait to share more of our favorite local spots in Santa Barbara and around the world in our next season. And finally, we end at the beginning of a new year, that is, which I felt was very apropos. Hi, I'm Lisa Lang with Spread Goodness TV, and we're out on New Year's Day 2023, and we're checking out different parts of town and seeing what people are doing to celebrate the new year.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
It is exciting. I'm so glad. Yeah.
Yeah, me too. Well, so tell me, what is Ecstatic Dance and what is your role in bringing it to Santa Barbara?
Well, Ecstatic Dance is basically free-form movement, and it's kind of a way of moving through prayer or prayer through moving, which sounds kind of heavy, but I mean, look at it. It's a beach party. It's having a good time, and it's ringing in the new year by moving the body and really letting the soul fly free, basically.
Yeah. I love that. Letting the soul fly free. Yeah. Very cool. And are you doing anything special to start the new year off right?
Definitely just have fun with the kids. It's going to be a priority.
I'm just like really excited about gratified as to everything that has been happening in my life and grateful. So
that's a great.
I want to give it back. I want to spread the joy.
Love it.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about.
Rest.
Rest.
Fun.
Hopefully sleep more.
Yeah, more sleep. Yeah.
Okay, rest, fun, sleep. I love it.
As we set our intentions for the new year ahead, I also reflect on what I'm grateful for this past year. My heart overflows with gratitude for my collaborating partner, Jake Potts. He has helped bring my vision to life through his extraordinary film and editing skills. His upbeat nature and can-do attitude have helped make this journey so much fun for me. I love working with him, and I can't wait to see what else we can create together. I would also like to express my gratitude to all the people we interviewed this past year. We love what each of you do to put more goodness in our world in your own unique way. Goodness is contagious, and you have inspired others to take action to contribute their own personal brands of goodness and make our world a better place. Thank you for watching. If you enjoy what we are doing with Spread Goodness TV, I'd like to request a simple action you can take to help make our endeavors sustainable. Head to youtube.com/SpreadGoodnessTV and hit the subscribe button, and follow us on Instagram @SpreadGoodnessTV. Also, we want to hear from you. What would you like to see in future seasons of Spread Goodness TV?